Cause and Effect. Carl lifted his head up from the cold, hard surface. The room was pitch black. He could hear the sound of soft breathing, but nothing else. His mind began to race through the possibilities. If this was heaven, it certainly wasn't how he'd imagined it. That would have been fluffy white clouds, brilliant sunshine, and gentle harp music in the background. But neither was it hell's fire and brimstone, although it did feel rather warm and clammy. He was sure that he must be dead. He remembered quite clearly the truck coming at him head on, and the sound of scraping metal as the bonnet of the car was sliced off by the truck's bumper. But that was the point at which it went blank. He was quite glad he didn't remember anything more, because playing that kind of thing over and over again in his head certainly would be hell. It hadn't been the best ever ending he'd had to a first date, that was for sure, and he didn't even want to consider what Kerry's fate might have been. He pushed himself up to his feet and tentatively moved forwards a couple of steps. He needed to find a light and sort out where he was once and for all, but he had the unnerving feeling that he was somehow high up, and that one false move would send him careering over a precipice. He had never been good with heights. He took one more step. Carl was wise to be wary, as he could now feel an edge beneath his foot, but he was just about to take a step back when something completely unexpected happened. It was the whoosh he noticed first, just before a solid lump clunked into his head and his body began to fly through the air. And then everything stopped. When Carl woke up again, he was back where he had started. He was sure of it because of the shiny texture of the surface beneath him. That was odd. A little bit too Groundhog Day for his liking. But if he was really replaying the time over again, his head wouldn't hurt. And his head did hurt a lot. He wasn't sure what had hit him, but it was very hard and very deliberate. Someone or something didn't want him there, wherever there was. He could still hear the sound of breathing, but there was also something decidedly more mechanical in the background, like the buzz of a small motor, and it was getting nearer. Carl decided it was best to remain completely still until he knew exactly what was happening. He really didn't want another missile to the head. Although he thought that the sound was quite familiar, he couldn't quite place it. There was also the faint glow of light. Not white light, but multicoloured flashing light. As it got closer, he could just about make out the outline. It was one of those wind-up toy robots, except that these days they weren't wind-up. They had the kind of chip in them that would have run the whole of the world's computers back when he was a kid. But the most alarming thing was that when it got up close, it wasn't tiny, fit-in-your-hand size. It loomed over him like a B-movie science fiction monster. It stopped, right by his head. He held his breath. "You're all right, then," said the robot. "We did wonder. That was quite some fall you took last night." Carl just stared at the flashing lights. He couldn't quite comprehend the fact that this thing that stood before him was talking to him. He had to be dreaming. But did you dream when you were dead? Or was he actually still alive in some drug-induced coma? "I'm Robbie," said the robot with a little chuckle. "Go on, I know you want to laugh. It's okay. Seems the powers that be do have a sense of humour, even if it is a bit warped." A huff of air left Carl's mouth. He couldn't stay still any longer. He gently touched the bump on his head. It was beginning to throb, and this whole giant toy thing wasn't helping. "Yeah, sorry about that,"
Kenzo doesn't like newcomers. Well, hates would be a better word, but that's why he's over here and not over there.
Robbie pointed in the vague direction of where the breathing sound was coming from.
Did the fall knock out your voice box or something?
Robbie continued.
Because Ron could have a look at that. He's good with mechanics. It can't be much different from working on the cars.
I can speak, said Carl. I'm just not sure I have anything to say.
Well, your name would be a good start, said Robbie. We don't want to call you Teddy unless that's actually your name.
Robbie chuckled again,
although Carl really couldn't see what was in the least bit funny.
He had to be alive and on drugs, lots of them. This was almost psychedelic.
My name's Carl, he said.
Great, Carl it is then. Come and meet the rest of the gang. Just follow my lights until you get your dark eyes. It isn't far.
Carl decided he had nothing better to do, so he got up and padded along behind Robbie. There were so many questions in his head, but those dulled into insignificance compared to what his eyes were beginning to take in. For a start, his body seemed to be much hairier than before, and he couldn't distinguish any fingers or toes. Just what he could only describe as oval blobs on the ends of his arms and legs. And as for his belly, somehow he had developed a rather rotund beer gut. He was so taken up in his thoughts that he didn't even notice that Robbie had stopped and nearly walked straight into him. They stood before two shelves where he could just about make out a dozen or so more toys engaged in animated conversation.
"Ahem," said Robbie, calling them to attention. "This is Carl. Let's give him a rip-roaring welcome to damnation."
Most of them did just that, but in amongst the cheers and greetings was one particularly surly face. A gangly chimpanzee with bright orange fur snarled at him.
"That's Kenzo," whispered Robbie. "Best keep out of his way. Serial killer. He hasn't lost the tendencies."
But that wasn't what had taken Carl's attention. He ran his blob hand up his arm. He looked at Kenzo's body, then back to his own.
"Has anyone got a mirror?" he said.
"I've got one in my stomach,"
piped up a small activity toy as it stepped forwards and revealed a tiny circular disc covered in sticky finger marks. Carl bent in close. Two orange-rimmed eyes stared back at him, and a large, black, shiny nose.
"No," he said. "No, this is a dream."
Whispers rolled along the shelf and heads turned. Robbie stretched out an arm.
"I'm sorry, mate," he said. "I thought you knew."
Carl sat next to Robbie with his legs hanging over the end of the dressing table, his head in his hands.
"So, you're telling me this is hell? That every bad person who dies gets reincarnated into a toy?
That's completely ridiculous. I'm sorry, I just don't believe it."
"Oh no, it's hard. I'm not saying that it's not. We all went through the denial phase when we arrived. But think about it for a minute. Don't you remember when you were a kid believing that you saw your favourite toy move? Weren't you convinced that they all came alive at night?"
"Well, yes, but that's just a child's imagination."
"A child's imagination can only be sparked by a glimpse of something truthful," said Robbie. Carl shook his head. That just sounded like some tin pot philosophical spouting.
"Okay, so say I believe you, which I don't. You say that this is hell, but you spend each night having a party. That doesn't sound like paying your dues for what you've done."
"No, at the moment we are lucky. Little Izzy is only 3 months old. But things will change, and quite soon, too. Wait here, I'll get Eli to talk to you. He's a hand-me-down. 6 generations and counting. He can explain it much better than I can.
Eli sat down next to Carl. His long, floppy ears almost covered his time-worn face. His once pure white bobtail was a murky shade of grey, and his eyes were dulled by the scratches of many years of play.
"The children ain't that bad, most of them," he said. "They're just playing. But playing isn't all about being kind. It's about seeing how high your teddy will fly, or stabbing its face with a fork because you're feeding it. You can't tell me you ain't never pulled the head off your sister's doll, or fought another kid for the best toy by each pulling on a leg. That's just the way it is, and it ain't pleasant. This is our recuperation time, when we can all commiserate with each other, and when we can help heal the wounds that the day has brought. Even a cute little button nose like we've got now can bite on your ear until it goes numb, or pee in your face. And then there's what some might see as the kindnesses. Cleaning you up by putting you in the washing machine, where water penetrates every fibre of your being, and then pegging you by your ears to the line, so that the wind can knock you back and forth until you're so breathless you wonder how you still exist. It ain't brutal in the way some of us done in our human lives, but it is constant. It truly is a living hell."
Carl sat silent for a moment and thought back to his own childhood. Suddenly it all made sense. He remembered the time that he had raced all his toys like poo sticks in the stream at the bottom of the garden, and the day he had lined up all his sister's dolls on the wall and picked them off one by one with his water pistol. Tears began to gather in his eyes. "How bad do you have to be before you get this?" he asked, looking down at the sheen of his brand new fur.
"Well," said Robbie, "we've kind of worked out that you have to be the whitest of the white to get reborn. Not that that means our little Izzy here will turn out the same this time around. But anyway, she used to be the kind of person most of us would have kept at barge pole length in our previous lives. A right goody two-shoes."
"And everyone else becomes a toy?"
"Seems so. That would account for why some children have so many. She'll have a roomful before she's 2.
"So all you have to do to become a toy is not be pure?"
"Yep. But there are grades. I mean, our Bella here on the wind-up music box, she just told the odd white lie and got drunk on birthdays and Christmases. So her incarnation is in a less danger-prone form. Whereas Kenzo, who kept a tally of the number of people he bumped off on his bedpost, is a cuddly toy. Maximum contact and, therefore, maximum danger."
Carl felt a lump forming in his throat.
"But I'm a teddy bear."
"Which begs the question, Carl, my boy. Just what did you do?"
"I don't know. I really don't. I would have put myself in the same category as Bella. I've never hurt anyone deliberately."
"You must have done something," said Eli. "You just got to think a bit harder."
"I don't know. I've never been in a fight or owned a gun. I probably had an argument once every couple of months. I loved my parents. I even loved my sister, although I didn't always show it. I worked hard, I..."
Carl stopped dead. A feeling of dread came over him. There was a question he needed to ask, but he really didn't want to, because a positive answer would surely explain his current situation.
"Spit it out, son," said Eli.
"Do insects and bugs count?"
He held his breath while he waited. He would have crossed his fingers if he had any.
"Just swatting the odd one wouldn't do it," said Eli. "That's just normal. We all done that."
"No, I mean collecting. Killing them.
like hundreds of them. In glass cases.
The other toys gasped.
Hundreds?
Said Robbie.
What exactly are we talking here?
All the toys were silent as they waited for his reply.
Mainly butterflies, said Carl.
Eli and Robbie began to edge away. Even Kenzo looked concerned. Carl swallowed hard. You do knows what butterflies is, don't you? Said Eli. Carl didn't know, but there was no time to reply. Izzy began to scream, and seconds later the light switch flicked on. Everyone remained still.
There, there, said Izzy's mother, gently lifting the baby up into her arms and rocking her back and forth.
The crying soon stopped, and that could have been the end of it. But Izzy's attention fixed on the dressing table. She stretched out her arm.
You want Teddy, do you?
Well, there you go. He's a lovely Teddy, isn't he?
He was a present from Auntie Maureen.
Carl stared into the distance. If he didn't look into the child's eyes, then maybe she would ignore him. But he could see Izzy's open mouth getting closer to his hand. He could feel her hot breath. He gritted his teeth and braced himself, because he knew that no one was going to come when he screamed.